Hey guys, hang on one second. Yeah, there we go. Hey, oh, it's working, sweet. I have a clicker, this is new. This is a whole experiment. My name's Daniel Burwen. I'm the creative director and founder of Keynote Comics. Tremendously honored to be here. This place is great. You guys think I'm so exotic with my accent. I'm from San Francisco. I was invited out here by Digital Derry, and it's a pleasure. So I'm a graphic designer. I've also worked in video games. I'm basically a storyteller that works at the intersection of art and technology. I worked for Electronic Arts and Activision back in the day, and for the past 4.5 years, I worked on an interactive graphic novel called Operation Ajax. Some of you might know that project. And normally I talk a lot about that, but today I want to really frame Operation Ajax in terms of a larger story. In terms of where art and technology go when it comes to driving our media experiences. So this is a quote by John Lasseter of Pixar, and he's really famous for, you know, sort of pushing that technology forward when he joined the company. And he says, "Technology inspires art, and art challenges the technology." And I really want you guys to sort of be thinking about that as a theme today, and sort of the things I talk about in the larger scheme of two formats, films and games, two formats that are dominantly used to tell stories. I'm going to start by showing one of the first movies ever made. This is called The Horse in Motion. This was made in 1878, and you know, it basically is film. This is sort of the first format that ever emerged for that, and you know, it hasn't really changed that much. And you guys might be looking at it going, "Huh, well, I don't know if that's really that impressive." Well, one thing to consider: it took us about 100 years to make three dots move on a screen after that. So this is the contrast, I think, between games and film. This is, you know, Pong, 1972. Basically, like 90 some odd years later, we get that. So in terms of a starting point between these two things, the sort of concept of fidelity sort of driving these two things forward, they start in very different places with very different results. And it's the quest for better and better visual fidelity that has driven games and film forward since then. They've remained very different media formats, you know, for a good reason, I suppose. They're fundamentally very different. But in 1993, in cinema, something very interesting happened that kind of forever started to bond these two media formats together. So I'll show you a clip. Everyone should remember this.
The Veriformin's been extinct since the Cretaceous period. I mean, this thing isn't hunting this thing. What?
That's exactly how I felt when I first saw Jurassic Park for the first time. And what's so funny is that same year that movie is achieving this like amazing level of fidelity, Virtua Fighter comes out. And this was the first 3D video game I'd ever seen. And so my mind kind of got blown twice. Because, you know, everyone's like, "Wow, I believe that that's a dinosaur." And games finally for the first time had like 3D characters. But again, the fidelity curve is very different between these two industries. But I think what's so interesting is that what this means is that 3D arrives as a tool for telling stories in both films and games with very different effects. If you want to consider these media formats in terms of their relativity when it comes to the fidelity curve, it kind of looks like this. You know, obviously The Horse in Motion, like 1878, starts out looking pretty good. The experience of watching that and watching Jurassic Park is actually not fundamentally that different. And if you think about the tools that are added since then, we get sound, we get color, we get animatronics in the 80s, and then, of course, with the advent of 3D visual effects, pretty much anything you can think of. And I think since Jurassic Park, it's really kind of leveled out, and we get little blips here and there when, you know, filmmakers try to dazzle us with the latest and greatest, and for, you know, sometimes story gets lost, and that's a whole different topic. But then you think about Pong, 1972, right, almost 100 years after The Horse in Motion, and it starts off really, really low fidelity, right? We get, like, three bars moving on a screen, and then it sort of, like, gradually goes up. When Virtua Fighter comes out in 1993, you know, film is basically leveling out. Games are just starting to take off. I mean, this is really the sort of beginning of the golden age of the console. And what's so interesting is that a year later, you know, Sony introduces the PlayStation, and you know, things are forever changed in terms of how we play games and how we tell stories in this medium. What's been driving the factor of these consoles is fidelity, and a way to sort of measure that in terms of the horsepower of these consoles is to look at something called texture memory. Now, without getting too technical, texture memory is a dedicated memory that stores textures that are used to illustrate or create the 3D graphics. The more texture memory you have, the higher resolution these texture images are, and the more realistic the graphics look. So if you just want to use this sort of arbitrary measurement of power, Virtua Fighter had approximately 1 megabyte of texture memory. The PlayStation 1 had 2 megabytes in 1994. 6 years later, we go to the PlayStation 2, and we have 4 megabytes of texture memory. In 2006, PlayStation 3 has 256. So the curve really is on this like crazy upward swing in terms of fidelity and what these consoles can do visually. But it levels out here, at least in my mind, because there actually hasn't been a new PlayStation since then. It's 2012, and we're actually due for a new one, and we haven't seen one yet. So what this means is that the console lifespan is 6 years, right? It's 6 years between every console, and fidelity, visual fidelity, is a driving factor of what keeps that sort of format evolving. And what's so fascinating about that is that, you know, I mean, it is starting to look pretty good. We're starting to get our dinosaur, so to speak, right? In the games era, this is Virtua Fighter now, and it looks pretty sweet. I mean, it really does make a big difference. So while fidelity is changing rapidly in the console world, in the world of video games, the interface has actually changed, well, hardly at all. This is the PlayStation 1 controller on the left, and this is the PlayStation 3 controller on the right. And, you know, it's very much the same. And we get the analog sticks, and we get, you know, vibration and wireless, and there's the 6-axis tilt, which I think is barely even used in most PlayStation 3 games. And so I think it just shows you where the emphasis has been in the past. It's about creating visuals that are more and more convincing, pushing that fidelity curve, because it started off so different from where film was. It was so lo-fi. But then something else happens in 2006, right after the PlayStation 3. The Nintendo Wii comes out, and it's literally half the fidelity of the PlayStation, and it vastly outsells the Xbox and the PlayStation, right? It just becomes the leading console, and I think nobody was really expecting that because everyone was expecting fidelity to be the driving factor. But the Wii did something new. The Wii had a completely new interface. And suddenly, you know, that PlayStation interface, which had been, you know, totally ingrained in a certain culture of gamer, and I think kept a lot of people out of games. I mean, I had, you know, occasional disasters with girlfriends where I'd hand them the controller and they would like run the character into the wall, and it's bad news, right? So it doesn't, I think you've all had that experience. You're like, no, this is really fun. You should play with me. And you know, that was a bad idea. Give it back. Okay. So, you know, but the Wii was like, oh, this is really fun and natural. And now now my grandmother can play tennis. Hooray. You know, like it really changed the living room dynamic, and it opened up gaming to this huge market, this huge, you know, group of people that were kept out by the interface. And so, you know, it obviously had an impact. I mean, like I said, there hasn't been a new PlayStation and there hasn't been a new Xbox in terms of the console, but we definitely got new interfaces on both of those, right? You know, Sony comes out with the Move and Xbox comes out with the Kinect, 2010 each. And so I think it really shows you, you know, how important that is and what an agent of change that can be, because fidelity is like fine now. Like the console games look really good and they're very expensive. And now I think it's really, you know, when you think about the other interfaces that are now emerging, Google Glasses are going to come out, I think, maybe, and that's going to be really new and weird, and you can like have even more of a bizarre interaction with people. You can ignore them when you're actually not ignoring them. You know, and then the Leap 3D is going to come out. I don't know if you guys know this thing. The Leap 3D is really cool. It's this like little tiny widget that sits on your desktop, and it projects this like space of like, you know, 8 by 8 feet or something, and it can detect a motion within a tenth of a millimeter. It costs $70. And it's, you know, they're just opening it for developers now. And, you know, so now you can have like, woo, like Minority Report in front of your computer screen. So, you know, it's a fascinating concept. But I think the overall idea behind, you know, what's going on here is that the emphasis has switched from fidelity to interface in terms of our technology, in terms of what drives us forward. And that's kind of cool. I mean, as an artist, I'm like, oh, right, you know, there's nothing I can't do now. And now it's like, well, how do people interact with these things, right? How does that change? So there was another interface that came out shortly after 2006, the iPhone, and I think that as an interface that comes into a sort of new area of computing and completely changes it, you know, this is probably the most revolutionary technology in the past, you know, easily the past 10 years. It's a fascinating concept what happens when somebody does something right, because it does have such a vast change. Just like Nintendo's console changed the emphasis for gaming in terms of what interfaces are, Apple made mobile computing accessible. And, you know, I don't know how many people here had a smartphone before this, but they were not terribly pleasurable things to use. You know, there's this lawsuit between Samsung and Apple. And this is, you know, mobile computing before the iPhone, where everyone's trying to figure it out, and there's like a, you know, thousands of different options, and they kind of work. Like, you have a Palm Pilot, and you can scratch at the screen, and you lose the stylus, and then you're like, why can't I use my finger for that? And you've got all these like foldable things, and it was really interesting because there wasn't really a right answer. There wasn't really a solution there that really worked. But as soon as Apple releases their iPhone, I mean, you know, everything is now a giant screen that you touch. So it just shows again, I think, you know, how important interface is in unlocking a new format of computing. And of course, you know, it's very interesting with a cell phone. It's a very different sort of model than the console. You know, it's 2006, we haven't had a new PlayStation, but every year since then we've had a new iPhone, right? 2007, 2008, you know, they go up and up and up. And what's so interesting to me is that, you know, if I do happen to own a console and I want to get a new PlayStation, I might not get a new TV, or I might not get the Kinect interface for it, and I might not get a new sound system. But every time that Apple releases a new phone, you get like a whole new system. You get whatever the latest data connectivity is, you get new sensors, new cameras, new resolution screens. So it's like a whole system update, and that hardware is constantly being updated. And our sort of, you know, use of it as consumers is different too. The phone lifespan is typically 18 months for a user before they swap out their phone and get a new one, right? Whereas a console is 6 years and you're not even guaranteed you'll have one. And again, the phone is driven by multiple aspects of technology, not just fidelity. So, basically the other sort of key difference here is that everybody has a mobile phone. It's part of our lifestyle now. Whether you play games or not, whether you, you know, use social media or all the other things that they do, you have one of these things, and you always have the option to opt into it. Okay, so the mobile phone. So what does that do, right? Well, obviously, you know, it makes phone calls, so I think everybody would use it for that. And, you know, okay, camera, everyone has, you know, a digital camera now, Instagram, very popular. And clickety-click, there you go, music, yes, okay, we know that. And okay, Angry Birds, unfortunately. Facebook and Twitter, and let's see, what else we got here? Netflix, right? So it does all of these, like, multimedia things. These are all things that were normally done separately, and now your phone, like, does all of them. But there's one thing it didn't really do well, right? It was small, and there was this, like, very special medium, like, you know, the book area. But then, of course, Apple fixes that, and now we can also read books. And so, you know, mobile devices are basically capable of running just about any kind of media experience you want to have, for better or worse, right? It's like this ultimate convergence device where you can now start blending together things that were normally separate. Because if you think about it, your console really only did two things. You could play video games on it, and you could watch movies on it. But this is, you know, these mobile devices are also communication devices, and now they can do all these other things, and they're mobile. So, you know, what that meant for us is that we basically took a book and my background's in video games, and so the, sort of the gameplay side of things, and we tried to remix them together to create something new. So, just in case anybody hasn't actually seen the book that I created, I'm just going to show you the trailer real quick, and we'll go on from there.
Introducing Operation Ajax for the iPad. Based on actual events of the CIA's involvement in overthrowing the Iranian government, a bold and original interactive graphic novel that redefines digital comics and the art of storytelling in 210 handcrafted pages. Navigating the comic is easy and intuitive. Tap or swipe to read the next page or to go back. Touching the middle of the screen gives you more control and lets you dive deeper into the rich history surrounding the story. At the bottom of the screen, we can flip through pages. It's also easy to jump to different chapters. A handy guide can be called up to provide a synopsis of the cast of characters. Occasionally, you'll see a star while reading. Touch it to pull up additional information about key story points. Historical documents that have only recently been declassified, and even newsreels from the era. Operation Ajax by Cognito Comics. Experience it at the App Store.
Ta-da! Oh, so, thank you. So Ajax is a really interesting experiment in learning how to actually blend new formats together without breaking them. And not to dive too deep into that, I did lecture on this at South By, and if anybody's curious, you can actually watch that online. But the idea here is that I think as a lot of these sort of things cross over, you sort of have to be cautious in what you do, but there's so much opportunity there. I'm going to sort of like not delve any deeper in sort of that format, but the idea that you can blend these things together is very powerful. And it really gets a little bit more interesting when you think about the technology that can drive these things. I don't know how many people here are familiar with Unity. Dan Brazelton and Tallchair built this amazing tool for us called Active Reader, and it's a multi-timeline editor, sort of like Flash or After Effects, and it runs inside of Unity. which is a game engine. And so, not to get too technical, but an engine is a piece of software, that drives a video game experience. It's a very powerful piece of software, and it's a full 3D world that can do physics and characters moving around and everything you would see in a PlayStation-style experience. Except we used it to make a comic book. And so what that means is that the entire world of Ajax, even though it's flat and slides around, is actually built in 3D. And even though we didn't really have the sort of room for experimentation, I mean, it's a 210-page historically accurate book. It was exhausting just making it work as a book. But there's all this opportunity for, I think, the next sort of generation of these experiences. You know, what does it look like when you move a camera around inside a book in a 3D world, right? So something that's handheld and you're reading it, but has all the power and capability to actually build camera movement, 3D characters, physics, whatever, you name it, also into that experience as well. The other thing that's happening that's also interesting is the concept of AirPlay. Just a show of hands, how many people actually know what AirPlay is? Okay, like 7. That's cool. All right, so AirPlay is a new technology also from Apple that allows you to wirelessly connect your mobile devices to television sets or anything else that really received it, a receiver for music and stuff. What that means now is that your mobile device doesn't have to just be relegated to being in your lap and being intimately sort of handheld, but rather you can actually use it to connect, say, an iPad to your television and simultaneously have a second screen experience for better or worse, right? And so there's a lot of possibility here because it changes the role of the device. You know, if you come home with your iPad or your phone, it's no longer the thing you're using to just text all day, so you can then go and do something far more rich, either on your desktop computer or in your living room, but rather use that exact same device in a different sort of interface, a different sort of world. And it gets me sort of really excited to think about that because, you know, suddenly a high-budget narrative like Toy Story or whatever doesn't just have to exist as a, you know, one room, one type of interface or experience narrative. You could theoretically have something that then shrinks back down and is actually just as fun and engaging as Angry Birds, but maybe part of a larger narrative, of something that is deeper, more rich, and actually is better to be experienced in both of those spaces, both in the living room or with friends, and then on the go in a mobile device. So, you know, if you want to think about the role that these mobile devices played in the past and how they never really felt like they could offer you the same experience that you know, PlayStation interface could, I don't think that's going to last very long. You know, I think that it's just a matter of time until you extend the idea that your phone is now also a controller for anything, as well as, you know, sort of an end unto itself. So I like the picture of this, a sort of, you know, game controller phone kind of idea. I'm not saying that's the way it would go, but, you know, just to give you an idea. Oops, I think we skipped one here. There we go. Okay, cool. So fidelity is still obviously a factor here, and anybody who does play console games, I think, is obviously going to be sort of, you know, well, they're mobile devices, and what can they really do? Well, this is Infinity Blade, and I think anybody who's actually played this game can say that's probably going to look, you know, if not as good now, it's going to surpass the PlayStation, you know, in terms of fidelity. So I don't think that's really going to be an issue. And again, as an artist who works in that space and really values fidelity in terms of what I do, I think that's really, really cool to think that, you know, it won't matter soon, and we'll be able to do any type of experience we want, and these devices will truly, really fill that role. So just to sort of recap the curve of this, and this isn't really to scale, of course, but, you know, the horse and Jurassic Park are 100 years apart, and then everything else is within the last 20 years, right? So it's this crazy curve of all these things coming out. And the orange dot to me is kind of like this, like, you know, well, where is it going? What is the future? And I put the infinity symbol in there earlier to kind of be like, we don't know where it's going. It's kind of constantly taking off into the wild, you know, great universe. But the idea of like this, you know, this idea of where, oh, there we go. The idea, you know, you don't really know what's not awesome. Anyway, thank you, internet. But the idea that, like, these things might just make us ridiculously stupid people, or they might make our lives better, or, you know, it might be all these things in between. And so I really like, you know, I have hope that interfaces will, just like anything else, make our lives deeper, richer, more connected, and not distraction-based, not us constantly, you know, pulling our phones out of our pockets so that we can, you know, ignore the people around us, because I think that's not really the point. I just wanted to sort of talk about one last sort of concept before I wrap things up. So we talked about this the sort of place for me where sort of games and cinema intersect. And it's been great being here. I've met so many creative people, and to be seen as a peer is just a real honor. And there was a panel yesterday with a couple of guys that are all doing interactive sort of cinema experiments and things like that. And the idea that we can now intersect you know, sort of games and film because the fidelity curve is no longer an issue and because interface is now really the challenge of how do we make these things compelling, I think it really opens a lot of doors. And I'm really excited to see how that evolved as we do, you know, we measure, you know, emotional responses and have that control the experience, or we shine laser beams at the screen. So plug for Renga. Please go check it out tonight. It should be really, really fun. But just one technology I want to show you real quick that does sort of experiment with this intersection of interactivity and filmmaking is by one of my favorite companies, Valve. So just another show of hands. How many people here have heard of Source Filmmaker? Oh, sweet, nobody knows this. This is great. This is why I'm here. I have to come from San Francisco to like tell you. So Valve is an incredible company. They're like the Pixar of the games industry, for lack of a better description. Apparently their employees like love it there, and it's like, you know, totally level. You can move your desk wherever you want and move to be next to the people you like, or they can move away from you. But it's like, why does nobody want to work with me? Anyway, it won't last long if that's the case, I guess. But they're a really amazing studio. They make these extremely rich, beautiful, you know, they made Portal, so you guys should hopefully know that game. You know, and just examples of really pushing storytelling and games together in really great ways. They have phenomenal internal tools, and one of them is called Source Filmmaker. It's literally like a film studio for doing animation, but doing it in real time. There's no actual rendering. It's sort of the opposite of Pixar in that, you know, Pixar artists and animators, they'll set something up and then they'll press, you know, okay, cool, I want to see what that looks like, click, and then it flies off to a render farm, you know, that costs like, you know, $500 million or whatever, and 30 hours later, back comes a frame of video, and that's what it looks like. And that's cool, I mean, that works. It definitely silos the industry, it's not like everybody can just do that. But what's happening now, because that fidelity curve is going up so high, is that you don't need to do that anymore. And we're seeing games now that do look photorealistic. I don't know if you guys played an L.A. Noire by any chance. Bankrupted the studio, unfortunately, but it was like the first, you know, realistic-looking characters in the game. What's so fascinating is that when you go stylized, you can really open that up. And what Valve has done, one of their best-known games, Team Fortress 2, has these great stylized cartoon characters, and now those assets are free to be played with. Like, they'll do an animation with them, and then you can download the scene and go in there and like reanimate and move the camera and dub in your own sound effects. And I apologize in advance because Google ads are probably going to pop up on top of this thing while I play it, but just to show you the power of what Filmmaker can do, this is, well, you'll recognize the movie, but totally redone with Team Fortress 2 assets.
You can play the stock market. We could make trillions.
Why make trillions when we could make billions?
A trillion is more than a billion, numbnuts.
All right, zip it.
You can't even...
Zip it. Zip.
Look,
ladies and gentlemen of the jury, exhibit A.
Number two, would you please back
Look,
me up?
Look, I'm zipping long stockings.
I can't.
When a problem comes along, you must zip it. Zip it good.
Would you
please do I bring the word? Me ta hiyo ito. Subtitle. Zip it.
I'm just trying
zip.
To.
Would you like to have a suckle of my zipper?
I want you. Stop.
Zip it.
Zip it.
Oh. Zip it.
You know
what?
You're like a child.
Zip it.
Talking. If you just one time.
All right, and Google Ads, thanks. All right, so yeah, so that was all done on someone's home PC. That was like not rendered, that was literally in real time, move the camera. So just an idea of where things can go. I mean, imagine just one last image for you. Like instead of having to animate that with a mouse and keyboard, imagine Leap 3D and Kinect and you just sitting there, you know, actually acting out whatever it is you want that character to experience and driving a performance like that and making your own cinema, you know, sharing all these assets together and repurposing stuff. It's really exciting. So that's sort of my vision for where storytelling's going, and I hope you guys found my presentation interesting. Thank you. If you want to know more about Operation Ajax, you can check out operationajax.com and more on me, Control It Creates. So thanks again, everybody.